Good morning, St. John's.
Good morning.
Let me call your attention to some of our announcements. The flowers in the sanctuary given to the glory of God in honor of Jim and Maybeth Thompson's 52nd wedding anniversary, so congratulations to them. They're also given today by Paul and Jeanette Isaacs and to the glory of God in loving memory of Bob Coachley. Please note that we will restart our Bible study on Wednesday mornings. We'll begin at 10 o'clock here in the sanctuary and go to 11:30, and it will be about God's deliverance, and we will start with the book of Deuteronomy, and we will work our way through all of the scripture, looking at all the different ways that God will offer deliverance for us. We have an opportunity, as we all well know, of the tragedy in Maui and Lahaina and Hawaii that we need to be in prayer about, but also we need to put legs to our prayers by helping them out financially. The United Methodist Committee on Relief is one of those organizations that is well known throughout the world that gives money to people who are in need. 100% of the money goes directly to the cause. So if you would like to do that, the UM Corps code is in the bulletin, but is 901-670. If you just put on your check Maui, we will make sure that it gets to the right place. Our United Methodist men will be meeting this Thursday night, August 24th at 6:30 p.m. in Ward Hall. And Reverend Will will be meeting with the men to introduce himself and to give some background of his own and to introduce his plans for ministry here at St. John's. I hope you'll come for that. It's always a fun time for the men to get together because they get to bring food that they normally would not be allowed to. May not be something on their list of preferred foods at home, but most men bring something that they will enjoy, and it will be a good time together. Once again, we want to encourage you to join our Wednesday evening programming and Wednesday night supper. The turnout for the last 3 weeks has been marvelous, and we hope that it will be as well this week. The menu, one of the things on there is one of my favorites, is meatloaf, and then the dessert this week, you can look in the bulletin and the other fixings as well. But tomorrow afternoon, 5 o'clock, tomorrow afternoon is the cutoff for the reservation, so please do that. And it's a wonderful time for our children and youth and programming, and also I'm teaching a Bible study from 6 o'clock to 6:45 in the chapel on the book of Revelation, so always fun to do. And I want to say a word of thanks, number one, for our fuel retreat. Our youth have been meeting in different homes in the neighborhoods in Aiken this week. This weekend, and the theme has been pause, P-A-U-S-E, not pause as in Clemson pause, but P-A-U-S-E, pause, and how we can pause and reflect and get to know God better. But we did celebrate pause, P-A-W-S, this past weekend. Our fall ministry kickoff was last Sunday night, and we had the Tiger from Clemson, the mascot from Clemson was here, as well as Cocky from the University of South Carolina. The only thing I've heard that we might need to clean up next year is to make sure that we've got Ugga here from the University of Georgia. So we will make sure of that, but it was a great time held had by all, and it was a wonderful time of fellowship. So those are our announcements. Please make note of the ones in the bulletin, and please make sure that you sign the registration pad, letting our folks know that you're here, and pass it along. And if you see names of those persons around you that you don't recognize, make sure that you meet someone. Make sure that you meet someone. Welcome to all of you.
Please remain standing while we affirm our faith using the historic Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. At this time, we invite the ushers to come forward for the morning offering. Please be seated. At this time, we invite all of our children to come forward to meet Reverend Will at the altar for our children's sermon.
Come on forward. The real test will be if I can stand back up. Come on forward. How are y'all today?
Good.
Good? All right. So I got a question for you, and I need your help. Do y'all ever remember getting an amazing birthday present or Christmas present or just a random present?
Yes.
Okay, tell me what it was.
Pokemon pins.
Pokemon pins?
The American Girl doll Seaside Diner from Mary Ellen.
The American Girl doll, excuse me?
Seaside Diner from Mary Ellen.
I cannot remember all of that, but is it American?
Santa.
Man, Santa Claus is doing good stuff.
Like guinea pigs?
Guinea pig?
Little
live pet guinea pigs. Woo! A Jasmine costume? Man. You got a real guitar? A country guitar. That's the only kind I know about. So, I'm sorry?
A robot?
Oh my word. Did you get something? What'd you get? You got an American Girl doll too? Wow. Well, I got to talk to my Santa Claus because they got to step up their game. But presents are pretty awesome, right?
Yes.
Gifts are pretty. Yes, they're fun to play with. So my wife gave me these. You know what these are?
Sunglasses.
Sunglasses, right? And, right? Well, if I get this present but I don't wear them, what good is it? It's no good, right? I can't keep the sun like out of my eyes, like when I'm riding down the road, or if like I go fishing, I can't get the glare off the water, or if I go snowboarding, I can't keep the wind out of my eyes. Like, it doesn't do any good if you don't wear them, right? If you get a gift but you don't play with it or you don't wear it. And I also don't get to hear my wife tell me how attractive she thinks I am with my shades on, right? Like, these are benefits of playing with your toys, okay? Today, we're talking about that Jesus gave us a gift, that he gave us life, real life, that when he lived and died and rose again, that we might live, he gave us life. So, what good is it if we don't use it? It's not good, right? It's no good if Jesus gives us life, but we don't take him up on it. You know, it's just like a Christmas gift, and we get it, and then we don't use it. Exactly. Just like getting a toy, but never playing with it. So, we're going to pray, and since y'all have got it figured out by now, all right? And I need y'all to also talk to Santa Claus for me because I need to increase my, like, I've been getting short-sighted on how compared to the gifts y'all are talking about. So, will y'all pray with me? Lord, we thank you for this day that you give us the real gift, the gift of life. And we pray that you will bless us to take you up on it, to truly believe in this gift, that we might live, that it's not just something that we receive, but something that we take hold of, an experience, and that we receive in the fullness, just like if we play with our toys that we receive from our parents and Santa Claus. Bless this day and bless this time, Lord, that might be the truth of your gospel heard and that the Spirit might live in us. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. And now, if y'all will follow the crucifer to Sunday school or children's church. We have now come to the time for prayer. And I invite you to bow your heads or take the posture that you feel that you should in time of prayer. Almighty God, we give you thanks for this day and for your goodness and grace. And God, we thank you that you meet us here, here at St. John's, here in Aiken, here in our homes, here at work and at school, and in our places of residence, and in our jobs. In every part of life, Lord, you meet us to give us life, that we might not choose death, but we might choose life. So bless this time, Lord, that your Spirit would speak. Lord, if we have not received your gift of the Holy Spirit, we pray that we receive your gift, that we might truly take you up on you living in us. As it says in John 1, that you set your tabernacle among us, that we might live, Lord, that we might face all of our struggles and pains, all the things that we brought with us, and you might bring us to life. We pray this in Jesus' name. And so, because we believe in your power, we will pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, good morning again. I know that y'all are the 11 o'clock crowd, and so y'all are, you know, the silent stoic type. See, I knew that y'all couldn't handle that. And I am so thankful to be here and to worship with y'all, as I've been doing for the last few weeks, and thankful for my family to be in Aiken. But we're glad for you to be here and to see God's grace and mercy happen here at St. John's. I must start with, if you think that your presence in a church is not important, especially if you sit in the balcony, about 2017, I was in between jobs and I had lived in Aiken and I actually came to visit St. John's. Most of you did not see me or know that I was here because I was still was in seminary, and so I was like, I need to sneak in and sneak out, because if you're a preacher, people go, don't you want to come volunteer, you know? And I was like, no, I'm in seminary. And so, but your presence and you speaking to people makes a difference. And so I invite you and encourage you to make sure that if you see somebody new or somebody you don't know as well, that you speak to them and share them with the grace of Jesus Christ and his love every time you get a chance. It was a joy to be with you that day. I even sort of remember what Pastor Tim preached about. So, just saying. Today's scripture comes from Galatians chapter 3, verse 14, and here's what it says. He redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles, that is, everybody that is not a Jew, through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. And if you hear nothing else, and if you remember nothing else from the sermon today, remember that Jesus is Lord. Because whatever you are dealing with, whatever you walked in here with, no matter what you deal with on a weekly basis, on a daily basis, on a minute-by-minute basis, Jesus is Lord, and he will meet you, and he will walk with you through it. He will reign supreme, that if your life is in utter chaos, like the disciples on the Sea of Galilee, when the whole world seemed to be swirling around and they think that they're going to die, Jesus is Lord, and He still can say, "Peace, be still." Jesus is Lord. Do we believe it? Do we hold on to the truth that Jesus is Lord? We are people that gather together on a weekly basis to say that Jesus is Lord. That's why we say the Apostles' Creed and the Nicene Creed. It's why we sing in the 902, "We Believe." It's why we sing these songs that people wrote over 100 years ago. It's why we read the Scriptures. It's because we believe that Jesus is Lord. The hard part of that oftentimes comes when you come home from work and your house is in chaos and your children have broken that thing that cost $100 or $1,000 and you need a whole lot of Jesus in order to make sure that they survive for another day. My parents received a whole lot of Jesus in my life growing up. Or maybe you need Jesus to be Lord when you go to the doctor and you come home and the prescriptions now are doubled and your income has no way of going up. And you need Jesus to be Lord to get you through that time. He meets us in every day and all of our struggles. So what does it mean if Jesus is Lord? What does it mean for us? It is no good if we hear that Jesus is Lord and we don't know what to do with it. Y'all are part of the congregation too. It means that Jesus is Lord. What do we do with this? What does it mean to be saved? Does it mean to go to church and read your Bibles and pray? Are the super Christians the ones that fast from food, not just from coffee once in a while? What does it mean to be saved? Does it mean you join the choir or go to United Methodist Men or you volunteer at the church or you go on a mission trip? What does it mean that we are saved? Is that enough? Is it enough to do these things? Is it enough to gather with people and to eat? Is that what it truly means to be saved? There once was a man who lived a while back, and he was a really good preacher, or at least he thought so. And he started teaching people and preaching, and he was telling people, if you just live by the way the Bible tells you, then you will be saved. If you'll go to church, if you'll partake in Holy Communion, if you'll visit the sick, if you'll visit those in prison, if you'll sing in the choir, even off key. Matt will straighten that out. If you will participate, right? If you'll do these things, then you will be saved. If you'll fast twice a week. And he did this to the point that he was made fun of. They're like, he's one of those Christians that like, that's not really what it's about. And so then one day he goes on a trip because they decide that he's such a good Christian, they're going to make him a missionary. So they send him to be a missionary, and on the way to his destination, there is a hurricane or a huge storm, we're not 100% sure. This huge storm comes by, and this man thinks that he's going to die. Now, it's just not a regular huge storm. This is a multiple day, this is not a cruise ship going by, a huge storm, or something like this. This is back in the day when if there was a storm that went by, you felt every wave, okay? Every up and every down. You experienced the entirety of the storm, and this man was convinced that he would die. And the crazy thing was, is that this preacher, this man that was sent to proclaim the gospel out in the mission field, was not sure if he was saved. He was not sure that Jesus truly was Lord, and yet there was a little group of people that were on that same boat. They got together, and they would sing hymns, and they would pray, and they had peace. The peace that surpasses understanding. The peace that only comes from Jesus. And they were okay. And this preacher said, "What must I do to be saved?" And the people just said, "Have faith. Have faith." And this preacher goes, "I have faith. I feed the sick, I clothe the naked, I visit the people in prison and visit the people that are sick, and I am in church every Sunday. I study the Word of God. I know Greek, Hebrew, and Latin. I am really good at all of these things." He knew that something was missing in his life. Have faith. Faith that Jesus is Lord. Do we have faith that Jesus is Lord? In the Gospel of Mark, unlike Luke and Matthew, Jesus starts the ministry and the Gospel starts with the heavens being ripped open and God says, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." And then what does he go and do? Well, he doesn't go to church first. Actually gets sent out in the desert. I'm not saying you need to go spend time in the desert. But he gets sent out in the desert. But then, after that, he comes back and he forgives sins. And people say, "Well, you can't do that. Only God can forgive sins." And he says, "In order for you to believe that I can forgive sins," he tells the man, "Get up and walk." And he heals the paralytic. And then he goes around and he teaches people, what does it mean to be a part of the kingdom of God? And people come from all over, and sometimes they get to the point that Jesus is preaching to like 5,000 people, and they get hungry. We know about that in church, right? When we get a group of people together, for some weird reason, they get hungry. Come to one of our Wednesday night things. I promise you, you'll experience people that get hungry, right? And what do they have to offer them? 5 loaves and 2 fish. And when we say that this is not enough, Jesus says, "But this is enough." And he prays and he feeds 5,000 men, not including women and children that are there. And all eat and are satisfied. This is the same Jesus that when he is in the synagogue and he is teaching, and a woman that has bent over for 18 long years comes in and everybody else is moving around her and has forgotten that she exists, Jesus stops his teaching and says that Christ has come for her. And he heals her that she might live. What else does he do? He speaks truth to power. He speaks truth to the leadership in the religions of Judaism, the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the scribes, to those that bind the law and tell people this is the way, but they do not give grace for people to grow in his grace. And Jesus even has the opportunity to speak to even to the power of Rome. Be very similar to us if we decide we want to go stand out at outside of the president's house, the White House, and speak and preach and expect things to change. And yet, they put him on a cross and he dies. This is the King we proclaim. This right here is not just some pretty symbol that we have in church. This is the King that we proclaim, the one that died in his obedience and his faithfulness to God. And in that obedience and faithfulness, he is raised up 3 days later to live. Which means that if Jesus can calm storms and Jesus can feed 5,000, if Jesus can heal the sick and clothe the naked and feed the hungry, if Jesus can die and rise again because the power of God meets death face to face, and life is more powerful than death, that means that whatever we face, life, that God can reign supreme. That is the message, is it not, of Paul in Romans? Neither life nor angels nor demons, powers, principalities, nothing separates us from the love of God. Jesus is Lord, but what good is this to proclaim it but not believe it? That's what the man that we were talking about just a minute before, if you hadn't figured out, a few weeks, or he spends a couple years in the mission field, he comes back still troubled with the question of, does he actually have faith? And in one Thursday, I think it's a Thursday night, he goes to Aldersgate, and he hears the preface on Romans, and he has his heart strangely warmed. And he knows that the love of God is for him. If you don't know who this story is about, it's about John Wesley. And I really love John Wesley, so if you hear me preach, you're probably going to hear some kind of form of Methodism or John Wesley over and over again. And so I'll go ahead and apologize. Y'all believe in the forgiveness of sins, so I trust that you'll forgive me. But that's not the moment that truly changes him. That's the moment that he feels the grace of God for himself. But the moment that it really becomes true is six months later. He's in a worship service with friends on New Year's Eve, and they're praying and they're worshiping, and the Holy Spirit comes down, and the power transforms the people, and the Spirit becomes real. And after that, he doesn't question it anymore. After that, he just starts pointing out to people that the grace of God is sufficient. That the King Jesus really does rule and reign in our lives. When death and destruction seem to reign supreme, Christ meets us there and says, no, that life is more abundant. That Jesus is reign is more abundant. And I'm going to tell you, it is a crazier thing for us to believe that, or for him to have believed it back then. We have vaccines. We have systems in place to make sure that people don't go hungry. We have things like Grace Kitchen to make sure that people are taken care of. And in the 1700s, they didn't have that readily available at every street corner. They didn't have hospitals for people to go to and bring life for people. But John Wesley preached that by faith we are saved. And because of that faith, what did he do? He did the means of grace all the more. He went to church. He took in Holy Communion. He baptized people. He preached that by faith that we are saved. I don't think he sang in the choir. Not that I know of. But he would tell you to sing vigorously. It's in your hymnal on the first page, that you should sing vigorously, praise God. I might not have that wording right. He healed the sick and clothed the naked. He went and he prayed for people. He experienced the truth of God in those places, because we know that when we do these things that God shows up. And we know this to be our story too, right? All right, I'm going to have to tell y'all like I did in 902. Universe is signed for yes. Universe is signed for no. Okay. We know this to be our story true. I know for myself that this is my story. I was baptized as an infant. I do not remember being baptized as an infant. Okay. My mother was missionary Baptist, so she didn't really believe in the sprinkling, and so we went to revivals, and so when I was like 3 or 4, I prayed the sinner's prayer. I don't remember praying the sinner's prayer. But I knew that God was real. That was never in question. I knew that God's grace and His love was real, and that was never in question. I was not always obedient to that grace. We went through that at the beginning of the sermon, right? I was not always obedient to that grace, but I knew that it was real to the point that, like, one day I was climbing in a tree. It was a sycamore tree, and it was this long branch that was hanging over, and I decided to climb upside down from one side of the branch to the other. I don't know what television show that I watched that you could do this, but I was climbing across, and there was a pipe sticking up out the ground, and I knew that if I fell, I was going to die. Well, I did fall, and I didn't die, and I was like, praise be to God, because if I'd have gotten hurt, I'd have probably had gotten hurt again when I went and told my mother how I got hurt. But then when I was about 12 or 13, I was homeschooled, so I was reading the Gospel of Matthew, and I came across Matthew 5, where it says, if you are angry with someone, you have committed murder in your heart. And so I realized in that moment that, like, that meant my mother, that meant my father, that meant my sisters. It meant, I don't know, who all I've been angry with before. And I knew that I needed Jesus because I couldn't quit just being angry. I grew up in a good home. It's not like there was something wrong. This was something that I struggled with. And I knew God's grace. And I knew Jesus was Lord. I wish I could say that I was filled with the Holy Spirit and I never had any problems after that. That is not the story that I have. I still got in trouble in high school. Not in a lot of trouble or anything, but But then I went off to Clemson. And Clemson was not my saving grace as much as I'd like to say it was. But I actually was not the best student. In fact, it was probably worse when the teachers figured out I could be smart. And they were like, why didn't you make better grades? But I got the sophomore year, and second semester, freshman year, and I had not had great grades. And I went to one basketball game. It was the only basketball game I had gone to that year. And Daddy calls me. Now, you got to understand, my daddy was valedictorian of his high school class. He went to Clemson. He got out of Clemson in 3 years, went on to vet school, graduated from the University of Georgia. He has a degree from Clemson for a professional degree. So, and for Daddy, like, it didn't matter. He was planning on going to vet school, so he would have quit everything if it meant to get those grades. So when I call him and I tell him, hey, Daddy, I'm struggling with school, and his response is not very grace-filled. He's like, anybody can get a B. I didn't really know who anybody was at that moment. And I was working hard as I could go. I had a good girlfriend at the time. We were studying all the time, best grades I'd ever had. But it wasn't enough. But Jesus met me somewhere in there. Jesus taught me that His grace was sufficient. That His love and His mercy is sufficient for my life. That I can forgive as I want to be forgiven. That I can love as I want to be loved. That anger isn't a defining quality, but love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and self-control are. Not because of me, but because Jesus is Lord. So the question that I have for us today is, will we take Him up on it? Will we receive the promise of God that we are no longer on the outside, but God has sent His Spirit and poured it out on all people, like it says in Acts, that we can face all things and know that His grace is sufficient for you and for me? Will we believe it? Will we believe it when we come home and we face whatever our children have broken? Will we believe it when the doctor tells us the bad news? It doesn't mean that we can't be sad or have problems. But it means that we put our hope and our trust not in our works, but in the work of Jesus Christ, because He is Lord. Lord of you and Lord of me and the whole world. Take Him up on His gift. Take Him up on His promise. And if you would like to receive the Holy Spirit today, please do so. Believe that Jesus Christ is Lord. And I promise you, He'll give it to you. Amen. I would like you to stand and sing, Standing on the Promises. May God bless you with His Spirit. May we receive His gift that the whole world will know that Jesus is King, that we might stand on His promises and face everything that the world has, knowing that Christ has died and rose again, that we might have life. Go forth and share that with the world, and I promise you will receive His blessing. Amen.